Of webinars and optical network technologies and protocols. This is your friend Brahmanand in the journey of learning. The main objectives of this particular series of webinars is to discuss about SDSONet, WDM, OTN, EML, NML and project management linked to optical networks development and testing. In the last session, we discussed about the history of SONET and SDH networks, which was linked to PDH. We discussed in length about PDH's advantages, disadvantages, data rates, etc. In this session, we are going to discuss about requirements of SDH networks, building blocks, mapping of PDH signals to SDH frame, details about SDH frame structure, etc. First, the requirements of SDSONet. Need for extensive network management capability within the hierarchy. Flexibility in OAM through overhead provisions. We saw in PDH that the overhead provisions in the PDH frames were limited and the network management capabilities was almost nil. The standard interfaces between equipment and support multiplexing formats for previous interfaces data rate supported by PDH. This is one of the key requirements of SDH, that we need to support all the data rates supported by PDH, and we should be able to have a standard interfaces between multiple equipment vendors. Facility to airdrop tributaries directly from high-speed signal. We saw that in PDH, the flexibility was nil to take out a small tributary from high data rate line. Need for interworking between North American and European systems. We should have SDH working with SONET as well as supporting both E and T carriers. Provide synchronization between NEs and making all the NEs to take reference from PRC. We shall see this in detail whether our SDH supports or not. Should support both electrical and optical interfaces. We saw in PDH that it was supporting mostly the electrical interfaces, but it was lacking to support optical interfaces. So our SDH should support both of these interfaces. Should support self-healing mechanism, ring architecture. This was lacking in PDH, so this has to be supported in SDH. Ability to support and transport all services of PDH and provide better interleaving mechanisms compared to bit interleaving during multiplexing. We saw in PDH it was supporting bit interleaved multiplexing, so how SDH provides byte interleaving is has to be discussed. Decrease stuffing bits during higher order multiplexing. We saw in PDH that when the data rate increases after a series of multiplexing, the stuffing bits, the percentage of the stuffing bits also used to increase. So this has to get reduced during the multiplexing of SDH. Okay, what is the difference between synchronous and less synchronous? In synchronous, in a set of synchronous signals, the distance transmissions in the signals occur at exactly the same rate. There may be a phase difference between the transitions of the two signals, and this would lie under specified limits. Say for example, my expectation of digital transition is somewhat like this. In SDH, the phase difference occurs almost the same. That is why it is called as synchronization. Whereas, if the phase difference happens something like this. You notice that there is a phase difference, a time difference in the digital transitions. This is asynchronous. If this phase difference is within the tight limits mentioned in Z811, then this is called as plesynchronous. In synchronous networks, all the network elements are traceable to primary reference clock, PRC, whose accuracy is 1 in 10 to the power of 11. It means that only one bit can go wrong in 10 to the power of 11 bits, which is derived from cesium atomic standard. Let's discuss about the building blocks in SDH network. The main building block of the SDH network is the network element itself. So what is this network element? Network element is a piece of hardware which moves signals between optical fibers. So this is my optical fibers. Then network element moves the signals between these two optical fibers. It will have connectors, high speed connectors and low speed connectors. The high speed connectors are called as lines or aggregates, and the low speed connector lines are called as tributaries. The building blocks of SDH includes a regenerator, terminal multiplexer, adder multiplexer and digital cross connects. These are all the types of NEs which are supported in SDH network. So what is regenerator? The name itself depicts regenerator. It regenerates clock and amplitude of the incoming distorted and attenuated signal, derives the clock signal from the incoming data stream and resends the data in the required direction. Assume my, after a distance, my amplitude of the signal is something like this, whereas my expected amplitude is high. What this regenerator does is it reshapes the signal as well as it increases the amplitude required. So it does mainly both the function. What is terminal multiplexer? Terminal multiplexer combines plesiochronous and synchronous input signals into high bit rate STMN signal. We'll discuss about STMN signal later, but for time being, let's understand that it is a synchronous digital hierarchy signal. STM stands for synchronous transport module of the order of N. So we can have STM 1, 4, 16, 64, 256, etc. Whose data rate increases in the same order. So in the terminal multiplexer, I have one high speed line and many lower speed tributaries. So PDH is a tributary which can get connected to high speed data line. If my SDH is a lower order STM, this can also get connected to higher order STM. Adder multiplexer, which extracts and inserts information at the same time. So I can connect between STM to STM, lower order STM to higher order STM, PDH to STM, and also this particular adder multiplexer can connect to both the direction. And adder multiplexers are mainly used in ring architecture, which we shall discuss in the next session. Next, and the most important building block in a SDH network is Digital Crash Connect. Digital Crash Connect connects or an extended version of ADMs to increase the aggregation. So what is this aggregation? Aggregation means I should be able to connect from any to any, means tributary to tributary, aggregate to aggregate, tributary to aggregate. So I should be able to connect this tributary to this tributary, on any tributary to any tributary, a tributary to STM, STM to STM. So any and every possibility is available in digital cross connects. So which increases the aggregation to a greater extent. Digital cross connects are also called as large cross connects or digital access cross connects. This is a layered architecture of SDH. A trail between origination point and the destination is called as path. A span from where the signal get originated and dismantled is called as path. A span between SDH multiplexer to digital cross connects is called as multiplex section, or a digital cross connect to another SDH multiplexer is also called as multiplex section. A multiplexer to regenerator is called as regenerator section. A regenerator to a cross connect is also called as regenerator section. And also regenerator to regenerator is also called as regenerator section. See, the most advantage of SDH lies in its ability to map the PDA signals onto SDH signal. So what is this mapping? The process of matching the signals to SDH network is called as mapping. How do I map? Let's take for example how 2 Mbps even signal, which is 32 bytes per frame, whose frame duration is 125 microseconds. So this is my raw even signal. Now if I want to map this or match this signal to my STM frame, I have to undergo certain process. The first step in mapping is called as making a container. A container is nothing but my E1 plus stuffing. So why this container is required? It's required mainly to equalize any timing difference in the PDA signal. So if there is any delay, a timing difference, a timing inaccuracies in the PDA signal, still I should be able to map this or manage this into my STM frame. So that's why I had 2 bytes of stuffing bytes. This is what is I call it as container. The next step is adding a path overhead, lower order path overhead. Lower order path overhead is added to monitor, manage and do operations and administration maintenance of the lower order signals. If I want to manage this even signal from source to destination, I need to manage the even through this lower order path overhead. So my virtual container is equal to my container plus lower order path overhead. The next step in mapping is to group. So now I have even capacity was 2. You can see it here, 2.048, that is 32 bytes into 8 bits into 8000 gives rise to 2.048 Mbps. So this particular even get converted to my tributary unit. Now this will have 36 bytes per frame. Now whose capacity is 2.304 Mbps. So addition of the pointer to virtual container is called as tributary unit. Now this pointer indicates the beginning of my virtual container. Wherever the virtual container floats in the frame is indicated by my pointer. This is what is called as aligning. Now, once I have this tributary unit, I will multiplex three such tributary units to have a tributary unit group 2. Note that we are doing a byte interleaved multiplexing from multiple tributary units. So my tributary unit group 2 will have 9 rows and 12 columns. So this byte interleaved multiplexing is one of the biggest advantages of SDH compared to PDH. The next step in mapping is to take such 7 tuck-2s, which are, so we saw that tuck-2 is made of 1 tuck-2 is equal to 3 TU12s. Now we will take 7 such tuck-2s and we will do byte multiplexing to get tuck-3. This is tributary unit group of the order 3. So I will add 2 bytes of stuffing bytes to after I multiplex 7 such tuck-2s, I'll add 2 columns of, it means 18 bytes of stuffing bytes to have 9 rows and 86 columns. This is what is called as tuck-3. I'll take such 3 tuck-3s. I'll do a byte interleaved multiplexing. I'll get 258 columns and 9 rows. I'll again add stuffing bytes and I will add higher order path overhead. So after this multiplexing, this is what is called as virtual container 4. This higher order path overhead is added to manage the entire payload of VC4. Now my VC4 will have 9 rows and 261 columns. So this is called as virtual container of the order 4. I will add administrative unit pointers to my VC4. These pointers indicate the beginning of my payload, wherever it could be. And once I had this administrative pointer, this is what is called as AU4. So AU4 is equal to VC4 plus higher order pointers. If I had 9 columns by 3 rows, regenerate suction overhead, and 9 columns and 5 rows of multiplex suction overhead, then this entire frame of 9 rows by 270 columns is called as STM1 frame. So this is what is my STM1 frame. So just a quick recap on what we did. We took E1 signal, we put into container by stuffing, we put a lower order path override to make it as virtual container 12, we put a lower order pointer and we called it as tributary unit 12, and we multiplexed such 3 tributary unit 12s to make tuck 2, and we multiplexed such 3 tuck 2s to get 1 tuck 3, and we multiplexed 3 such tuck 3 to get VC4. We added higher order path overhead to tuck 3 to have VC4. We added higher order pointer to get AU4, and ultimately we got STM1 signal. Please make a note that if this signal of E1, if it has to sit in an STM4 frame, then I will stop here. I will group this with multiple other administrative unit. I will call it as administrative unit group. That administrative unit group would be called as AEG4, and then I will have STM4. Similarly, say for example I have 140 Mbps signal, a PDH rate, I can put it to container 4, I can directly have VC4, after adding a pointer I'll get AU4, and then I can have STM1 frame. So in the SDH multiplexing hierarchy, there is a huge flexibility to adopt and map any PDH signal to any or group of any number of PDH signals to my STM frame. Now similarly, C3 used for mapping 34 Mbps or 45 Mbps signal. And similarly, C11 is for 1.5 Mbps, which is equivalent to T1. So I can map 1.5 Mbps signal as well to my STM1, STM4, STM16 frame. Now, see, if I have one STM1 frame, we saw that there are 63 events can be multiplexed. And similarly, if we have STM4, 63 into 4, there will be 256 events can be multiplexed and mapped to my STM4 frame. Now, how do I simplify and for easy understanding, how do I number these events? Now, we know STM1 has a line rate of 155.52 megabits per second. So, to simplify, we use numbering scheme called as KLM numbering. So, we know now STM1 frame has one VC4. VC4 has 3 tuck3s. And each tuck3 has 7 tuck2s. And each tuck2 has 312. Now, let us say I want to represent even time slot in STM1. Say for example, I want to put this 56th time slot or 56th even in STM1 in KLM numbering. How do I do it? Now, we know that it has got 3 tuck3s, tuck3 number 1, 2 and 3. Now, each tuck3 has got 7 tuck2s, tuck2 number 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. Now, my even is sitting here. So, how can I represent? My first is my tuck3, tuck3 number 3, then tuck2, tuck2 number is 5 here. And similarly, my TU number is 2. So, even number 56 can be represented as 352 using KLM numbering. This is easy way of representing. And this will help in, during the development, I'll say it helps making cross connections in the network elements. This particular KLM numbering scheme also helps. So we have taken KLM numbering only for one particular STM. So this, say for example, for STM1, assume we have 16 STM4 or STM16. How do we represent? So STM16 will have 16 VC4s. So the number starts from 1 to 16. So I can, if suppose this particular VC4 falls into say 7th VC4, then I can represent it as 7-3-5-2. So this is the use of KLM numbering. So now we know my STM1 frame has got 270 columns, it has got 9 rows. So 270 multiplied by 9, we get 2430 octets, 2430 bytes. So this is the frame which has to get transmitted within 125 microseconds. So this will get transmitted first, the first column byte from left to right and then top to bottom. So this is how my data get transmitted. So now this is about STM1 frame. So now, just to summarize what we discussed today, we discussed how PDS signals can be mapped to my SDS signal. There are provisions for every PDS signal to get mapped onto my SDH frame. And we also saw how STM1 frame can be structured and how it is formatted using mapping, aligning and multiplexing. So in the next session, we'll discuss some key topics related to layered architecture of SDH, overhead bytes, production schemes, etc. Keep watching. If you like my webinar, please do subscribe to my channel and click on like. And if you have any comments, please leave the comments. Thanks for watching.